Well, okay. I think we can start. So welcome everybody. So this is the second lecture of today, and it's going to be by Martin Heirer. Please.
Okay. Thanks, Giuseppe. So what I would want to start with today is to first sort of show you a very simple graphical construction for this sort of infinite temperature ballistic deposition model that we introduced yesterday. So remember, the model was the following. You have a height function h, which takes values in the integers. X takes values in the integers as well. T is continuous. And at every integer site, you have an independent exponential clock. When the clock rings, the value of h at that site updates itself. And it updates itself in the following way. The new value at the site x is one of these three possible values. So either it goes up by one, or it takes one of the two neighboring values. And the finite temperature model would be the one where this happens with probability proportional to the exponential of the height, of the new height. And what we're going to look at is the case beta equals zero, infinite temperature. And so in this case, you just choose one of the three values at random. Okay, so you just take them with identical probabilities, a third. And so here is a very simple graphical construction. So you have, so I'm going to draw space sort of horizontally. Now space is an integer lattice, so at every point I have a timeline. Okay, so these are my vertical sort of timelines at every point x. And so now let's say I have some initial condition at time zero, so that will be time zero. And then I have some subsequent time, t. And now the claim is that you can construct the value of the process at time t in the following way. So what you do is, well, at every integer lattice, you have this, you have a Poisson point process, but now your Poisson point process, it throws down three different types of events. And so the three different types of events are either sort of arrows pointing to the right, arrows pointing to the left, or say cookies. So that would be just maybe I can draw them orange. Maybe this is more visible. And so these happen with identical probability. So one way of viewing it is you have a Poisson point process at every site, but then at every event of the Poisson point process, you choose an independent random variable that takes three possible values, and the three values are either arrow pointing to the left, arrow pointing to the right, or cookie. And then you draw these on this picture. So you get a picture that sort of looks like this. So you have a bunch of cookies. So they are just thrown down according to a Poisson point process with intensity a third. Then you have arrows pointing to the right that are thrown down with a independent Poisson point process, also with intensity a third. And then you have arrows pointing to the left that are also thrown down with respect according to a Poisson point process with intensity a third. So you get a picture that sort of looks like this. Okay, that looks sort of reasonably random. And now the way you construct your process is, well, if you want to have the value of the process at some particular point in space and time, say this point here where I put the red dot, then what you do is you backtrack. So you go down the white lines, but then you follow the arrows when you encounter them. So here I encounter an arrow pointing to the left, and so I move to the left, and then I continue backtracking. And so here I encounter another arrow pointing to the left. So again, I backtrack. Here I encounter the tip of an arrow pointing to the right. So I just continue backtracking. Remember, I just follow the arrows, so I don't go left because that would be going against the arrow. And so here I just go all the way down. And then I reach a certain value here. And now the claim is that the value of h at this point here then is actually just given by the value of the initial condition at this site plus the number of cookies that I've eaten along the way. So here I've encountered two cookies. There's one here and there's one here. And so the value here, say h, whoops, h at this point t and x is equal to h naught at x naught plus 2 in this particular case, where this here is the site x naught. Okay, and this gives you really the joint distribution of the h's. So if I take another site, and I can take another space-time point. So for example, I take this one. If I backtrack, well, here I just follow the arrows, and you see I end up at the same point, but I've eaten no cookie along the way, and so the value of h here at this space-time point is simply the value of the initial condition at that time here, etc. Right. So if I follow, for example, I start here at this neighboring point, then I follow like that, like this. I go down, I end up here, and again I've seen here I've eaten two cookies along the way, and so the value here is again equal to the value here plus 2 because of these two cookies here. Okay. So is it sort of clear how the graphical construction works? And hopefully it's sort of clear why this actually gives you, why this is a construction of this process, right? Because the cookie corresponds to these events, and then arrow to the, okay, so now I have to think about, so arrow to the right actually corresponds to this event here, right? Because if you have an arrow to the right, then it means that the value, okay, so I should have, right. So if you have an arrow to the, so these arrows, they are actually associated to the point processes that arrive at their tips, I suppose. And so you see, if you have an arrow to the right, that arrives at this point here, it means that the value of h at a time slightly after the event happens at this point is actually equal to the value of h slightly before this event happens, but at a point just one to the left, right? So that corresponds exactly to these type of events. Now, of course, that one is exactly the same thing, but the other way around. And that type of event, well, if you have a cookie, then the value of h at that point here, just after the event, is equal to the value just before, because that's exactly how I defined the graphical construction, right? So I hope it's clear. So if there's something not clear about this construction, then you should really raise your hands or ask a question in the chat or something now, because this is absolutely crucial for the rest of the lecture. I'm going to get back to this. I'm going to refer to this construction very often. And so if there's something you haven't understood about this, then you should really ask about it now. Okay.
There is a question by Milton.
Okay.
Is the noisy water model this guy modulo 2?
I'm not sure what the noisy water model. So the water model would be exactly this guy without the cookies. Now I'm not sure what the noisy voter model is. Milton. Hello, Milton. Can Milton unmute himself?
Yeah.
He wants to ask.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, so, yes. So in the noisy voter model, sometimes you just change your mind because you want it so.
So what do you mean by change? Oh, I see.
So that means that you have some cookies that tells you when to change your mind, no?
Okay, so
and... so the in the noisy water model you have exactly the same picture because you have the cookies that tells you that when you change your mind, when you go from red to blue, from blue to red, and then there are arrows that lets you get convinced by your neighbor, no?
I see. Okay, yeah, so then that sounds exactly like that modulo 2. Yeah. That's right. But so here H takes arbitrary values, right?
Yeah.
So it's not just two values.
Exactly.
And so in this construction, actually the values of H can only increase. I mean, in some, it's not really true. The values at one site can of course decrease because they can take the neighboring value, and the neighboring value might be lower than the existing value at that site, right? So along these kind of backwards characteristics, values sort of increase. And it's clear that on average, values increase essentially at a rate of third. So now, well, I hope from the graphical construction, it should be somewhat clear what the correct scaling limit is and what the constant is that I should subtract. So if I now look at H at a scale X over epsilon, then, well, if I look at time at spatial scales of order one over epsilon, then it's certainly quite natural to look at time scales of order one over epsilon square, right? Because the these backward characteristic here, they are just essentially simple random walks, continuous time simple random walks. And well, if you want them to have some kind of scaling limit, you need to use the Brownian scaling. So if I scale the x value, which is by one over epsilon, then I have to scale time by one over epsilon square so that these guys converge to Brownian motions, right? And then what about the value of h? Well, in time, one over epsilon square, so now here I look at a very large time scale for the one over epsilon square. Well, I've typically encountered about one over epsilon square of these cookies, right? And I actually have encountered on average one over three epsilon square because they are thrown down according to a Poisson process with rate one over three. And so a natural thing to do here would be to subtract one over three epsilon square, right? So that I get something, I remove sort of the law of large numbers if you want. So I get the fluctuations. And then for the fluctuations, I would have some kind of central limit theorem, right? So after one over epsilon square, the typical number of cookies that I'm going to see is a Gaussian. Well, the fluctuations are going to be essentially a Gaussian with variance one over epsilon square. So the typical value would be of order one over epsilon. And so if I want to get values of order one, I would have to multiply this whole thing by epsilon. Right, so, and so what I want to do is I take the limit as epsilon goes to zero of this quantity here, right? And that would be my H Brownian castle of x and t. Okay, so the Brownian castle is this limit. Now, from the construction,
Martin?
Yes.
Sorry, there is a question. Should you have t somewhere when you subtract the average? So it's t over 3
yeah,
epsilon
square. Yeah. It should be t over, yes, thanks. Yeah, so of course it's t over 3 epsilon square. Yeah. And so now it should be somewhat clear that the k point, if you take k space-time points, then you can sort of easily guess what would be the description of this Brownian castle, of the sort of k space-time marginals for this Brownian castle, because what you do is you just do the continuous analog of this graphical construction, right? So if you have, I think what goes wrong with beta, when beta is not equal to zero, then what happens is that you get a bias, right? So here you have a bias towards the high values, which, okay, maybe I can, maybe a little, maybe I get back to that question a little bit later. Okay. Yeah. So if I don't, then remind me maybe in half an hour or something. So the continuous analog of this construction is somewhat clear, right? So I have a, again, I have space, which is now continuous. I have time, which is still continuous. And now I choose k space-time points. So let me choose, say, five of them. And now what I do is, well, so these red trajectories, what are they? Well, if I take two of these pieces of trajectories, they are just independent continuous time random walks up until the time at which they meet, right? So if two trajectories meet at some point, well, then going down, they're going to follow the same arrows at the same time, and so they're going to actually stay together. So these red trajectories here are continuous time random walks that coalesce. And so the continuous time analog is obviously just coalescing Brownian motions. So you just take independent Brownian motions starting from each of these points. And if they meet, then they just coalesce. And so you get something like this. Right. And so now you have some kind of tree structure here. And now what you want to do is you want to look at how many cookies you collect, right? So how many cookies you collect, you want the fluctuations of this, right? So the average value has been subtracted. So the average value was this t over 3 epsilon square. So I just want to get the fluctuation. So that, so here you just use the central limit theorem. And what happens is, again, if you look at this tree structure, so you have these branches, right? So here I have a certain number of branches, which is, right, so I have this branch here, and then I have another branch here, I have sort of a third branch here, then I have this bit of branch here, I have this piece of branch, I have this piece of branch, I have this branch, and I have this branch here. Right, you see what I did, I just look at all the junctions here, and imagine I cut this into pieces. So here I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 pieces, and here I have another 1, 2, 3 pieces. Okay, so I have 8 pieces of trajectory here. And on each of these pieces of trajectories, the cookies that I'm going to collect are going to be independent just because of the independence properties of the Poisson processes. And so I'm going to get the fluctuations of the number of cookies that I collect. So the average number of cookies that I collect for each branch is simply 1/3 times the length of the branch, right? Where the length of the branch here is length in terms of time interval. Okay, so what I drew in yellow now. And so the fluctuations are just going to be a Gaussian random variable with variance equal to the length of this branch, right? So what I do now is I just draw independent Gaussians. So I have a Gaussian, say, let me call it, say, B1 here, and B2, B3, B4, B5, and so on. And the BIs are normal with variance zero, with mean zero and variance delta TI, where delta TI is the length of the ith branch. Okay, so the length of this branch, So say delta t1, for example, would just be this time minus this time here. Okay, it's the time length of the corresponding branch. And then if I want to get the value of my process at, say, this space-time point here, so h at this point t, I put x as a first argument. So then that would be, again, h naught of x naught, where x naught is this guy here. And then in this case, plus, well, you look at, you add up the fluctuations for all the branches that you traverse on your way back, right? So here you traverse the branch 1, 3, and 5. So here you would add b1 plus b3 plus b5, okay? And so on. So for example, if I take that guy, then the value here, the value of h at this space-time point would be equal to the initial condition at this point in space plus this Gaussian random variable plus this Gaussian random variable. Okay. So I think it should be relatively clear how this construction goes, right? So it's clear that if I just fix a finite number of space-time points, like 5 in this example, then I can do this construction for any finite number of space-time points. And that gives me joint random variables that are the h's at these finitely many space-time points. Of course, if you want by Kolmogorov extension, this construction, they are all consistent, right? So I can actually just get a random variable for every space-time point simultaneously. But as usual, it's just Kolmogorov extension. You know, it tells you that you have some sort of probability measure on some kind of insane space, but it doesn't really give you much of a hands-on, you know, properties of the process that you've constructed in that way, right? So what you want now, ideally, you would want to apply, you know, something like Kolmogorov continuity to have something about the sample path properties of this process. But obviously, Kolmogorov continuity is not going to apply here because we've seen in the simulations yesterday that the limit definitely didn't look like it was actually continuous in X. Okay, so there's not much hope of being able to apply Kolmogorov continuity test. And so the question now is, and that's the question that I'm going to address in the remainder of these lectures, is, well, on the one hand, what can you actually say about sort of sample properties of this process? What kind of pathwise properties does it have? Sort of which kind of spaces does it live in? What does it look like? Does it look somehow locally like some existing process or not? And also, what kind of spaces does it live in, and in which sense, in what sort of topologies can you say that this construction here converges to this continuum construction here? Okay. So that's the type of questions that we're going to address basically today, tomorrow, and Thursday. And then Friday, we're going to sort of go on from there and explore a little bit open questions. So the first thing here is, if some of you have heard about, maybe you've seen lectures about the Brownian web, then of course you recognize that the first half of this construction is just the Brownian web, right? So if I just look at these red trajectories here, these coalescing Brownian motions, well, here I start them at 5 different points, but of course, if I want to look at the whole process, I would really want to start them at every single space-time point at the same time, right? So you want some kind of object which corresponds to coalescing Brownian motions, independent up until the point at which they coalesce, starting simultaneously at every single space-time point, okay? And so this is an object that has been quite well studied, which is called the Brownian web. So here is a sort of picture of what the Brownian web looks like. I suppose you can see that, yeah. Does it zoom? Oh, no, it doesn't. Oh, yeah, it does zoom if I do that. Okay. So here you can see a pictorial representation of the Brownian web. So here, the way I drew the pictures is that the trajectories, the color of the trajectory corresponds to the starting time. So you know, if you want the hue, sort of like the color of the trajectory depends on the starting time. And then any given, if two trajectories coalesce, then the remaining bit is going to have the color of the older one of the two. Okay. And a priori, it's not clear that this notion of age is sort of well-defined, but actually the fact that I can draw that picture in some sense almost proves that this is well-defined, or at least suggests very strongly that this is well-defined. So here you see there are some, so what you can see in this picture is there are some rather old trajectories. So there are, these are the ones that are kind of in red, purple type colors, like this one here, or this one here that goes down all the way. So they are the ones that kind of start near the top of the picture. So here, for example, you have a purple one that starts up here in the left, and then you see it goes down all the way here. And then others that start later coalesce with it. So for example, here you have a red one that kind of starts somewhere around here, and it goes down up until the point here where it coalesces with this long purple one. And then it continues in purple because the purple bit is the older one that kind of started all the way near the top, right? And then you have, for example, you have these green bits that kind of start later on here and coalesce here into one of the red guys and so on, right? So this is what this Brownian web looks like. And so first question is, what type of object is this? Right, so here I've drawn it just as a coloring of R2 in a way, but that's not really the way we want to think of this. One way, the standard way in which the Brownian web tends to be constructed, so there's a series of papers by Ronfeng Sun and Chuck Newman and Fontes, and maybe there are some other co-authors, I don't remember. So there are two or three papers by these authors in which what they do is they view the Brownian web as a collection of trajectories. Oh yeah, Ravi Shankar said, thanks. So they view the Brownian web as a collection of trajectories. So here, I just showed you a chunk of it, right? So you should imagine that this goes on in all of R2. So first there's the problem that R2 is not compact. So that's a little bit annoying because typically you want to sort of look at what happens in some kind of bounded region, so you don't really care about what happens far out. So you want to do some sort of compactification. So what they do is they essentially turn R2 into a lemon, meaning you compactify R2 into some kind of shape like this, where in a way what you do is you have time, again, you have sort of time vertically, you have space horizontally, but what you do is you first compactify time in such a way that instead of going from minus infinity to infinity, you know, you make it sort of go on a compact interval, so you essentially add a point at plus infinity, which is the tip of the lemon here, and you add a point at minus infinity, which is the bottom of the lemon. And then for each time slice, you kind of compactify space so that you add a point at minus infinity here and a point at plus infinity here. But then as time goes to plus infinity, you sort of put these all together, right? So the compactification is not a square, right? So if all I did is really just compactify for every time turn space into an interval, then I would actually get a compactification which is a square. So I don't do that. So at time infinity, I want to only have one point, right? So I don't want to have in some sense, a whole space interval at time infinity. So what they do is they compactify R2 like this, and then they view the Brownian web as a collection, as a subset of the space of continuous trajectories in this compactification. Okay. So then it turns out that the Brownian web is going to be a compact subset of the space of trajectories in this compactification of R2. And so then they view it simply as a compact subset, and the topology they put on compact subsets is just the Hausdorff topology. Right? So they view the Brownian web as subset of trajectories in this Lemon compactification of R2 with Hausdorff topology. I mean, the Hausdorff distance. Now, this is somehow a slightly, this is not quite the way that we want to view these things. And the reason is that this is not a very good space because it doesn't quite keep track of the tree structure. So we want to keep track, because you see here it was really important to keep track of this tree structure because this is what we use then in order to add these random variables, these BIs, on all of these branches, right? And so we would like to view the Brownian web as an object which somehow keeps track of that tree structure. And this here doesn't really do a good job at that. So for example, in the space of compact subsets of the space of trajectories, trees are not a closed subset, for example. All right, so that's a bit annoying if you want to study convergence and keep track of the tree structure. Another problem here is that, for example, if you imagine a tree which looks like this, right, so it really just consists of two branches that are essentially parallel, very close to each other, and they at some point they coalesce and they go down. And now imagine, I don't know, that this is somehow length one, this goes down to infinity or so, and the distance between these two guys is epsilon. And now I send epsilon to zero. What do I get in the limit if I just view these as subsets of the space of trajectories? Then I have two distinct trajectories, which then in the limit become identical. And so as a subset, first I have two points, or as a tree, first I have a tree with three branches, and then in the limit I just get a tree with one branch. But I would really want to say, right, so intuitively, the limit of this object should really be a tree which keeps this structure, and it's just that two of the branches happen to be on top of each other in the way that it's embedded in R2, right? In the sense that, you know, if I want to then add these random variables on each of the branches, I would really want to add one random variable to this branch, one on this one on this piece of branch, right? And then in the limit, I would get a perfectly nice limit as epsilon goes to zero here, where this branch is sort of doubled up, and the two copies have two independent random variables assigned to it. Whereas if I view this as subsets in the space of trajectories, then I can't do that because I lose one of the two branches in the limit. Okay. So we are not going to view the Brownian web in this way. So we're going to view it slightly differently. So we want to actually introduce a stronger topology on the space in which the Brownian web lives, which keeps track of that tree structure. So now there's a very natural, so first there's an abstract notion of trees, which is, so maybe before I continue with this, I can actually get back to Fabio's question. I haven't forgotten you. So one thing that you see in this construction is, well, imagine that you have points, that you have two points that are very close, but so that the two pieces of Brownian motions that emanate from them actually don't coalesce, or only coalesce after a rather long time, right? Now, this seems very unlikely, right? So if I just take two points somewhere that are very close to each other and I draw two independent Brownian motions, well, it's going to be very likely that they sort of almost immediately coalesce and then they stay together. But then actually, if you look at that random variable, sort of the time that it takes for them to coalesce, that's a heavy-tailed random variable. And so if you look at sufficiently many of these pairs, there's actually going to be some that are going to stay apart for quite a long time before they actually coalesce. And we're going to see a bit later that this really happens very often here. So there are many points in which in the continuum limit, you actually have two Brownian motions that emanate from the same point, but don't instantly coalesce. They actually separate, and then they coalesce later. So if you have a point like this, then you see that this corresponds to a discontinuity, right? Because what happens is that now imagine that you have, so here I drew the two points as being separate, but if I imagine them as being the same, so if you have a special point like this, where two Brownian trajectories emanate from the same point here, then what happens is that in a way, the value of H is not well defined at that point, right? So there are two different possibilities. One is to follow this branch and add up the values, the Bs, according to these Bs, pieces of branch. And the other one is to follow this branch and to add up the corresponding values of B, right? And that's exactly what we saw in the simulation. So this is really going to be the discontinuities that we saw in the simulation yesterday. Okay, so these discontinuities are going to correspond to these special points from which you have more than one Brownian motion emanating. And now what's going to happen is that, well, you can take a dual point of view, and so instead of looking at these backwards characteristics, you can ask yourself what's going to be the motion of these discontinuities. And it turns out that the motion of these discontinuities is itself going to be described by coalescing Brownian motions. Okay. So you have a sort of nice description of what the discontinuities themselves do. And so now if you, and they are just, again, simple Brownian motions, so they are kind of running independently. And then the height of the discontinuities does something more complicated. Now, if you take beta, not this beta, but this beta here, non-zero, so if you take actual finite but not infinite temperature, well, then what happens is that here you get a bias in what you do. And the bias is towards large values. And what this really means is in terms of these discontinuities, what happens is that the discontinuities, instead of performing Brownian motions or random walks, they actually pick up a drift where the drift, the size of the drift, depends on the height of the jump of the discontinuity. And so now it becomes, you don't have an explicit description of the whole thing anymore. Right? So you don't just have a graphical construction like this, because of course these probabilities really depend on the values of H themselves, and they depend in principle on the whole configuration. And even if you want to somehow describe just the process in some other way, you can in some sense describe it, you can try to describe it via its discontinuities and the height of the jumps at the discontinuities, but then they start to do something complicated in the sense that they actually pick up some kind of drifts. And then you see sort of features that make it look much more like it should be in the KPZ universality class, and that's precisely what you expect, right? Meaning that instead of these backwards characteristic here simply being independent Brownian motions that coalesce, you expect to you still have a picture with these backwards characteristic, but then they should be, you know, distributed according to some sort of polymer measure where you have to solve some kind of random optimization problem for these guys. And so it would be closer to something like that. Okay. Right. So we want to view the Brownian motion, the Brownian web, as something which is called an R tree. And so an R tree, what is an R tree? So that's basically a real tree. So a tree not in the combinatorial sense, right? So in the combinatorial sense, a tree is simply a graph without loops. An R tree is not a combinatorial object, it's a topological object, right? So it's an actual topological space. It's just that it's a topological space that really looks like a tree in the sense that, you know, it's a bunch of intervals glued together like this, for example. So that would be an example of an R tree. Points don't have to be only sort of triple points. So you can have several branches meeting at one point, but you could have lots of points, right? So for example, some of you have heard talks about construction of the continuum random tree. So the continuum random tree is a random R tree, which doesn't consist of finitely many branches, but like infinitely many branches. So here we want to do something similar. We want to view the Brownian web, which is, this object here. We want to actually view it as a random topological space where, the points are points on these trajectories, right? So you have these trajectories here that are just all these coalescing Brownian motions. So you want to view points on these trajectories as points in your space with the distance given by, if you have a point here and a point here, for example, what you want to do is you want to just follow the trajectory starting from here. You follow the trajectory starting from here. You look at where they coalesce first, and then you say the distance between these two guys is that distance plus that one. Right? So basically the ancestral distance in that coalescing structure. Okay. So what is an R tree? If I want to take an actual definition, is an R tree T is a metric space such that if I take any two points, there exists a unique isometry F that goes from the interval of length distance between these two points, right? So this is a metric space, so it comes with a distance. That's the distance of that metric space. And so you have a unique isometry, which is such that f of 0 is the first guy, and f of the distance is equal to the second guy. And furthermore, if you take any injection, say q, from an interval into t with, say, well, I again call q of 0 z and q of 1 z bar, then q is just a reparametrization of f. Okay, so a tree, it's a metric space which has the property that if you take any two points in the space, you can find a path that connects them. And furthermore, there's actually a unique path that connects them, which doesn't backtrack, right? So there's only one way of going from any one point to any other point without ever backtracking, right? That's what this definition says. It's kind of clear that this is, I mean, intuitively, you sort of see that this gives you this forces your space to essentially look like a tree, right? So if you have this space here, if you take two points, for example, I take this point here, or maybe I use yellow, I take this point here and this point here, well, there's only one way, which is this one here, that I can join these two points without ever backtracking, right? So if I get sidetracked anyway in any of these side branches, well, then I have to go back, right? And then it's not injective anymore. On the other hand, as soon as I add a loop to this tree, and so if I add a loop like this, then obviously this property fails. So if I take, for example, these two points, now I actually have two paths that join them without ever backtracking, because I can go this way around the loop, or I can go that way around the loop, right? So I hope it's clear that this is a reasonable definition of what you mean by a tree in the sense of an actual metric space rather than a combinatorial object. So most of the properties that we're going to use of our trees are going to be somewhat obvious properties. So I'm going to, if you want, just state them whenever I need them and sort of ask you to take me on trust that the properties are true. They're going to be sort of intuitive things. Maybe there's one definition which is not completely intuitive, which is that, first, you see, in this definition, for example, if you have a real tree which has a sort of branch like this, this definition doesn't force you, it doesn't, in some sense, whether you add the endpoint of the branch or not is kind of up to you, in the sense that the open interval 0, 1 is an R tree, but the closed interval 0, 1 is also an R tree, right? So both of them satisfy these definition. And so it's just that the open interval 0, 1 as an R tree, it's not complete. Okay, if you take it with the usual Euclidean distance. Yeah. So we are always going to look at complete R trees. So a complete R tree would essentially have to include its leaves. However, you can, even if your R tree is complete, you can still have somehow like infinite branches going off to infinity. So for example, here, this branch here could very well sort of go off forever, but then maybe this one as well and this one as well, right? So this is a perfectly fine R tree. And it's just that you have like three branches that go off to infinity. It's a perfectly nice complete R tree. It's just that it's not compact. Okay, so now in our case, this Brownian web, well, again, it's not going to be compact because Well, it takes values in all of R2. So if you want to take as a distance this ancestral distances that I just described, where the distance between two points is simply the sum of the two time intervals up until the coalescence time, well, then I have points that are the arbitrary long distance from each other, because if I take a sort of very positive time here and a very negative time here, the distance between these two guys has to be at least that long, even probably even longer. So if I view the Brownian web as an R3, it's certainly not going to be compact. Okay. And so potentially you could have some of these branches that go off to infinity. And so one claim is that for the Brownian web, I actually have exactly one of these branches going off to infinity. So like the tree that I just drew would never appear as a realization of the Brownian web because it has three branches going off to infinity. And so you would want to have a definition, you know, sort of like just what do you mean by a branch going off to infinity? Okay, and so definition here is first, well, array is say an interval. So in an R tree, I have a notion of interval simply because I have, you know, I have lots of injections that go from actual intervals of R into my R tree. So if I take the image of such an injection, I call that an interval in the tree, right? So an interval could be here, for example, any sort of piece of branch like that, that's an interval, this is an interval. And then of course you can be half open and half closed depending on whether here you include the point or you don't include the endpoints, right? So array is a half closed interval. So in the sense that one side is closed and the other one, I don't say whether it's open or closed. So it could be closed on the other side as well, or it could be open. Which I'll say array, say from Z is a half closed interval, which is closed. So here it's closed at the point Z and it's open or closed on the other end, it might be infinite. And its array, if it is maximal for inclusion, meaning that you cannot extend it anymore, right? So here, for example, if I take my point Z to be, I don't know, say this point here, then if I take this interval here and I stop at this point here, this is not array, right? Because I can actually extend it further. So I can find a longer interval which contains this one. But now if I go all the way to this leaf here and I stop at the leaf, then this interval cannot be extended any further. So this would be array, okay? And then an end is an equivalence class of rays where, well, so if I have, so how are two rays equivalent? They're equivalent if they meet at some point, right? So my two rays, I have one interval, say starting from Z, and then either going on indefinitely or stopping somewhere. I have another one starting from Z bar, And now if they meet at some point, so in the sense that if I can go from Z to Z bar by staying in my two rays, then I say that the two rays are equivalent. So this is my equivalence relation. And an end is an equivalence class of rays. Now, clearly, if I have a leaf, for example, like this leaf here, that determines an end because I have an equivalence class, which is simply all the rays that end at that leaf. Right? So if I have any two rays that end at that leaf, well, since it's a leaf, if I go there from any other point, well, they have to actually meet before hitting the leaf. Right? So a leaf, by definition, is a point which is such that if I remove the point, my tree remains a tree. It doesn't sort of fall apart into two pieces. And that would mean that there's essentially only one way of reaching it. So if I start from any two points, and I want to go to the leaf, then I have to first meet, and therefore the two rays will be in the same equivalence class. Okay, so a leaf determines an equivalence class, but then there are some ends that are not determined by equivalence classes, and these are what we call open ends. Okay, so so an end is closed if it is determined by a leaf, and open otherwise. Okay, and if you think about it for a bit, you somehow, you know, you can sort of convince yourself that the open ends really correspond to branches that go out to infinity in your tree. Okay, so if you have a branch, at least in a closed tree. Okay, so if your tree is not complete, then you can have ends that don't go out to infinity, and that corresponds to leaves that are missing, if you want. Right? But if your tree is complete, then the only way that you can have an end which is open is by going out to infinity. So here, for example, you have one end here, you have one end here, and you have one end here. Right? And the equivalence class is, for example, for this end here, the equivalence class consists of all rays that are of the following type. You start somewhere, and then you end up, you know, you go out to infinity. You start somewhere else, you go out to infinity. And if you go out to infinity along the same branch, then at some point you coalesce, and that means you're in the same equivalence class. Right? Whereas this end here, well, that would be that would determine a different equivalence class. Okay. So you have these open ends that correspond. So for complete trees, the open ends correspond to sort of branches going out to infinity. So, oh, it's already four. Oh. Okay, so maybe what I'm going to do let me just spend 10 minutes to introduce a space which is going to be a space of our trees, but that are not just abstract metric spaces, but that come with a sort of embedding into R2. Okay, so that, because that's what we want for the Brownian web, right? We want to view the Brownian web as a tree, but it's a tree that actually comes, you know, it sits in R2. And so it's basically a tree with a map from the tree into R2, which is going to have certain natural properties. And so for the moment, we define a space T alpha SP. So the alpha, so T stands for tree, SP stands for spatial in the sense that it's embedded in some actual space. And alpha is some kind of Hölder exponent. And it's going to be a Hölder exponent for the embedding. And so an element of that space, they consist of what? So they consist of a complete pointed, in the sense that you also add a distinguished point to your tree, R trees that are locally compact, and that also come with a little alpha Hölder. Continuous map that goes from my tree into R2. Okay, so what I mean by little alpha Hölder continuous is, well, alpha Hölder continuous just means that, well, M of Z minus M of Z bar is bounded by distance between Z and Z bar to the alpha times some constant. And it's locally alpha Hölder, so that constant is sort of bounded in bounded regions. And little alpha Hölder means that if I take a small region, then that constant actually becomes arbitrarily small. Okay, it's sort of like the same as the difference between bounded and continuous. And the reason why we need this is because otherwise we don't have separability of that space. But that's really not a big deal. And so an element here, an element of that space, say zeta, we're always going to write it as a pair tau m, tm. And then possibly sometimes there's the distinguished point, which we're going to write star, and there's the metric, which we call d. I think there was a question. Can an R tree have no rays? It can have no, well, it always has rays unless it's empty. But it can have no ends. That's right. So it can have no open ends. Okay, so if you just take the closed interval 0, 1, then it still has rays, right? Because, for example, a ray is just maximal for inclusion. It means you can't continue it any further. So if you take the closed interval 0, 1, you take your point z somewhere here, then, for example, this here all the way to the end is a ray that emanates from Z, because I cannot go any further. There is no larger interval starting from Z which contains this interval, and therefore it is maximal for inclusion. And this you always have, unless the tree is empty. But you may have, and so you always have ends, but you may have no open end, right? So in this particular case, you have two ends, and the two ends are closed. Okay, so here we have these R trees that come with an embedding into R2, and so now we want some kind of topology on that space, right? So the claim is that there is a decent topology on this space, which turns it into a polished space, and it's not completely obvious how to do that, right? Because you see, what do you want to do? So if you have two of these guys, so you have zeta, zeta prime, just t prime, m prime, star prime, d prime, whatever, right? So what you would want to do is, so let's assume even that they are compact, right? So I'm going to, so the elements here, the trees only need to be locally compact. Let's for the moment remove locally compact, turn it into compact, okay? So then, for example, the distance between t and t prime, a natural thing to do is to just take the Gromov-Hausdorff distance, right? So the Gromov-Hausdorff distance between two metric space, one way of viewing it is you say, well, I look at all the ways in which I can embed these two metric spaces into one, isometrically, into one large common space. And then I take the usual Hausdorff distance. So now they are compact subsets, because I assume compact, they're compact subsets of this larger space. And I just look at the Hausdorff distance between these compact subsets. And then I just take the inf over all possible ways of doing that. Okay? So that's the Gromov-Hausdorff distance. So that would be sort of a natural way of turning, measuring the distance between these two guys. Then, okay, so if you have the two guys, they're sort of embedded in a common space. That means that I have a notion of sort of proximity between points here and points here. You know, you sort of can sort of imagine that this can give me sort of a natural way of measuring distances between the ends. But then the problem is that I actually want completeness. And the sort of thing that you have to worry about here is the following type of thing. So imagine that you have a sequence of trees. Again, well, okay, so if everything is completely compact, there's no problem. But when it's only locally compact, so imagine that you have the following sequence of trees where you have a, right, so they're kind of embedded into R2 like this. And say here you go kind of down to infinity. And this coalescence time is very large or sort of very negative, right? So this coalescence time, you think of it as being very far down. But then, and say your distinguished point star is going to be some point here. For example, this is the distinguished point star. And then the way of looking at distances between locally compact trees, well, the standard thing to do is, well, since they're locally compact, that means that if I take, say, the ball of radius r around star, then that gives me a compact tree. And so I just look at the distances between balls of radius r, and then I do that for every possible value of r, and that, you know, put these distances together in some kind of standard way. And now the problem is if I send this guy sort of off to infinity down there, then what happens is that this branch here is actually in the intrinsic distance of this tree. This branch ends up being very far from the origin, right? So the limit of this guy, as this goes down to infinity, the limit is going to be the tree where this gets just completely cut off, right? But this is not a very nice property, because the way we want to extract that on this tree, we're going to want to put these b random variables on each of the branches, right? And then we want to actually extract the process from that. We want to say the value, what we're going to have is at the end of the day, we're going to have a tree which has sort of lots of branches starting from pretty much every point. And then we want to extract the process out of that by saying that the value of the process at some point is obtained by essentially following the branches of that tree until you get to time zero and so on, and adding up these b's along the way, right? Now what happens is you have this branch here that contributes to the values of the process in this region. And now if I send this guy down to infinity, then this is going to, if I take the naive somehow distance between these guys, this is going to converge, but it's going to converge to a tree which is amputated of this branch here. And so then I have a piece of my process which before the limit, you know, lives in a perfectly nice and bounded regions of my space, which then suddenly disappears into thin air at the limit. Right? And I certainly don't want that. So that means that I'm going to have a lack of continuity of the map that goes from that space into some space of processes in which we want to look, in which we want to view the Brownian castle at the end. And so we want to avoid this type of situation. And so one way of avoiding this is to somehow control what we call the properness of the tree. So the properness is you define a map B zeta of R, which is the supremum over all z's, so that M of z is in, say, the ball of radius r. So this is the ball of radius r around the origin in R2. So you look at all the points of my tree that get mapped into a ball of radius r around the origin of R2, and then you look at the distance of these guys from the distinguished point star. So now here, you see that this quantity is going to go bad in this example, right? In the sense that here, I have points that are closed that get mapped, that under M get mapped to a region, you know, which is relatively close to the origin in R2, but so that the intrinsic distance between this point and star gets very large as this goes out to infinity. So that means this intrinsic distance gets very large for some not so large values of r, which means that for this example here, this function would sort of, you know, diverge to infinity. And so what we do is we cook up a metric on this space, which also controls this quantity here. So it doesn't just look at the Gromov-Hausdorff distance between these guys and some sort of distance between these two guys, but it also looks at the distance between these two functions. So you view, so this is going to be an increasing function from sort of R plus to R plus. And so you take the graph of this function and you look at sort of the distances between the two graphs. And that's going to give you nice control, which prevents this type of phenomenon from happening. Okay. So this is the type of space that we're going to want the Brownian web part of our construction to live in. Okay, so the claim is that now, so I'm going to write down sort of the actual distance function next tomorrow, but you can, in some sense, almost guess what it is by now. So then we're going to also have to put these bees onto the branches of these trees. But then the claim is that, you know, this graphical construction, the continuum analog of the graphical construction, we can actually turn it into an actual random variable on some space like this, which, you know, we have a metric which turns into a nice kind of polished space. So the type of spaces that you can do probability theory on. And we make the space nice in such a way that extracting the Brownian castle, so extracting this kind of height function h from this graphical construction is still a continuous operation. Okay, so I think it's probably a good point to stop here for today. If there are still any questions.
So, well, at first, let's unmute and thank Martin for the nice talk. And now, if there's any further question, you can either unmute yourself or write on the chat. Okay, so so if this is not the case, then let's. Okay, so if this is not the case, then let's thank Martin again with a round of applause. So are the lectures going to be online? So this is a question I'm asking to the organizers, since I didn't see.
Yes. So they will be online on the YouTube channel of Infra.
Okay.
So they should be online any minute, essentially.
Okay, perfect. And okay, so then thank you, Martin, again. And I think we're going to see each other tomorrow, first for Perla's talk, and then Martin again at 3 o'clock UK time and 11 a.m. Brazil time.
Exactly.
So, okay. So thanks a lot and see you tomorrow.
See you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Okay. Bye.
Yeah. See you tomorrow.